comes from the book of Exodus, chapter... Let me start again. Actually, our scripture lesson comes from the book of Genesis, chapter 26, beginning in verse 17. So Isaac departed from there and camped in the Wadi Gerar and settled there. Isaac dug again the wells of water that had been dug in the days of his father Abraham, for the Philistines had stopped them up after the death of Abraham. And he gave them the names that his father had given them. But when Isaac's servants dug in the valley and found there a well of spring water, the herders of Gerar quarreled with Isaac's herders, saying, "The water is ours." So he called the well Esek, because they contended with him. Then they dug another well, and they quarreled over that one too. So he called it Sitna. He moved from there and dug another well, and they did not quarrel over it. So he called it Rehoboth, saying, "Now the Lord has made room for us, and we shall be fruitful in the land." This morning, I'd like to speak to you on the topic room. Room. Pray with me. Lord, you know everything about us, and so we're not going to pretend or perform. We are simply going to humbly ask this day that you would come into this space and work through me, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts would be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. As the middle child of three girls, I have an affinity for Isaac. I know what it's like to have your name come second in the litany of three. The placement most easily forgotten. I know what it's like to be overshadowed by the elder and misplaced by the younger. And although we resemble each other now, when we were younger, my two sisters favored my mother more than I. Their hair behaved, and mine had a mind of its own. I have a great affinity for Isaac. Son of Abraham the patriarch, father of a great nation, and father of Jacob, the trickster who wrestled with God. The only one who didn't get a name upgrade, Isaac. And I suspect if Lin-Manuel Miranda made a musical called Patriarchs, that they would introduce themselves like this: Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac. Isaac doesn't get as much attention in the text. Abraham's cycle starts in chapter 12 and goes all the way to chapter 25. Jacob's story begins in chapter 25 and goes to 37. So poor little Isaac is sandwiched in between those two. When Turner Broadcasting Systems made the series, The Bible, they made an Abraham movie and a Jacob movie. And Isaac got to appear in both of them. Scholars uniformly observe Isaac as a character is the least developed. And one scholar, Ellen Davis, reminds us the two biggest moments in his life, he is lying down and being acted upon. At the near sacrifice in chapter 22, and then in chapter 27, when his wife and son conspire to deceive him. Another scholar makes the observation he makes no major contribution, no new idea, no profound insight. You don't have to do a master's thesis in Genesis to know that Isaac doesn't get presented like his father and his son. Isaac has a name, but he doesn't make one for himself. He's a character that's kind of like Tyrone. He just can't be by himself sometimes. It's Isaac and Ishmael, Isaac and Abraham, Isaac and Sarah, Isaac and Rebekah, Isaac and Esau and Jacob, Isaac and Abimelech. So it should not surprise us that in our scripture passage this morning about digging wells, Isaac is attending to the wells that his father Abraham dug. Right? His big moment when he's doing something by himself, he's doing something that's not very exciting, but necessary. If you're going to survive in the wilderness, you're going to need to build wells. Digging wells is providing water for humans and animals and plants. We find water sources and we dig wells so that we can survive. And as he moved from place to place in pursuit of God's promise, Abraham would dig wells. He would dig a well and he would mark it. And he would put his mark on it. And the mark meant, this here well belongs to Abraham. For Abraham and his family and his flocks and his allies and his descendants, so they could have water. All of the wells dug by Abraham were places where Abraham's family knew they could return and stay a while and rest. The well is literally and figuratively an oasis. It's the equivalent of the Negro Motorist Green Book. Here are the places where you can go and be safe. I may be a stranger in this territory, but if I can just make it to the well my father Abraham built over yonder, I'll be okay. Wells are safe space and sanctuary. And long before the prophet ever uttered the words, these nomadic people understood and wanted to live in peace and unafraid. And I want to pause here for a moment because I think it's important to say, whether you're in the Bronze Age with Abraham in the ancient Near East, or you live in Flint, Michigan, or in Jackson, Mississippi, or in Gaza, that most people just want to live in peace and unafraid. People want water and the necessities needed to sustain life and thrive. So much of Abraham's existence is given to wandering, that whenever you get a chance to build a well, you're gonna mark it. Because when you do so, it feels like you're securing a future for your family and their children and their children. Remember who Abraham was, called from his home, uprooted, always an alien or a stranger or a wanderer with no rights and no land to call his own. So for people who had been dispossessed, those wells had a lot of meaning. Let me explain it this way. When I was a senior in college, I inherited my sister's car. It was a Plymouth Volare. Some of you don't even know what that is. Somebody knows. Whoever's laughing really hard knows what it is. Plymouth Volare, it was in pretty bad shape. The tires, I'm pretty sure, were bald. The battery would die all the time. And I didn't trust it for long trips. But when I parked that car, I would park it way down at the end. You know how people do with nice cars, so that nobody would hit it? And what I should have done was let somebody hit it. The point here is, the way I felt about that car, because it was my first car, was disproportionate to its value. Yeah. Think about that for people who are wandering and then dig wells. When you are a nomad and you dig a well, you are excited because you have provision in water. And not only do you have provision, but if you build that well and you mark it, then you can go whenever you want. You have permission to go get that water. And over time, you develop a sense of pride. You say, my father Abraham built this well. This is my family's well. And if you're not careful, then you will become the purveyor of that well, deciding who gets to come and who doesn't. And then, if you are not careful, you will exercise privilege and start to say, I deserve this well, and you don't. Somewhere between provision, where we're saying thanks to God, and privilege, we lost sight of the fact that you can dig a well, but you don't make water. Prosperity and longevity are a blessing, but they have the potential of bringing a curse. Beware of the slippery slope that starts with provision, where we're saying thank you, Lord, to privilege, saying I deserve it. Pick a church, any church. Pick any ministry, altar guild, vestry, missions. And I suspect that you will be able to identify one person who came into leadership saying, thank you, Lord, and 3 years later is saying the words, can't nobody lead this group except me. When it starts being about more than your ministry, when your blessings become a privilege, when you become the gatekeeper deciding who gets to come in and who doesn't, I want to invite you to come and sit with Isaac. Isaac is a person who doesn't have wells associated with him. Abraham has wells. In the Gospel of John, we learn Jacob has a well. Abraham and Isaac have wells. Nope. Abraham and Jacob have wells. Isaac does well work. Stay with me. Isaac redigs Abraham's well. And when he redigs it, he doesn't name it after himself. He gives it the name his father gave it. He understands the need for legacy. We need institutions. We need security. We need things that are established. But if we don't have some Isaacs, our establishments won't last. Isaacs are the people who know about the ministry of restoration. Isaac redug the well of his father Abraham. So digging wells is a huge enterprise in the ancient Near East. Many of these wells were hand dug with simple tools, moving through the soil and rock to get down below the water level. And then after you hit the water, then you have to line the well with stone so that you're filtering the water. And then you have to move a huge rock on top so that animals and or people don't fall inside. But redigging wells is a different kind of excavation, because you have to go in and work within a pre-existing structure. You don't want to mess up the good work that's already there. You have to remove the unnecessary landfill that your enemies placed there and leave the good work. It's easier to build a new well than to do the discernment of deciding what stays and what goes. Redigging, because the well is worth it. We redig because I know there's good water down there. I redig because some things can't be duplicated. When that child comes home from school filled with dirt that the crazy teacher placed in him, we need to dig out the well. When that person is trying to respond to God's call and gets all kinds of responses about why they can't serve and why they're not worthy and why they're not the right person, we've got to dig out the dirt. And when that church leader, after years of service, is filled with the dirt of disappointment and people who just won't do right, we got to dig out the dirt. And if we're honest, you and I are here today because somebody took the time to carefully excavate some dirt that somebody put inside of us. Isaac dug wells because the people needed water. But over time, Isaac had to dig wells because, as God blessed him, he needed more. But in the narrative order, pay attention, the new wells come after he redigs the old well. And perhaps the text is inviting us to consider that we have to reckon with our past if we want to move into a better future. And I'm glad to say here at VTS that I'm at an institution where we have made an effort to go back and tell our stories about our own dysfunctional family, about our Hagars and our Ishmaels and all of those people who worked silently for nothing or little. We can't move into the future God has for us until we finish telling that story and dig the dirt out. When we go back and redig, we learn from our ancestors. And we must learn the past, because Isaac digs new wells, and as he does, all the old issues show up. As soon as he digs the well, here come people out of nowhere. Who does this belong to? Whose name goes on it? Who has rights? Who has access? And they quarrel with Isaac, who dug the well. And so when he's at Esek, he doesn't stand his ground. He keeps digging. At Sitna, he doesn't stake a claim and plant a flag. He keeps digging. Isaac, when confronted with people who want to take something that belongs to him, doesn't fight them. He keeps digging. He keeps going out. Isaac is a patriarch. A patriarch. He's one of the big three. He's a patriarch who gave up his privilege. Isaac understood that he could dig wells, but that he didn't make the water. And so Isaac kept digging, because he understood it's not the well we need, it's what comes in it. Sisters and brothers, this morning, don't confuse the work you do with the movement of God. All we do is make space. All we do is make room. God is the water. God is what we need. So don't ever be afraid to keep digging. Keep digging. Keep digging until you come to Rehoboth, until you find some room.